So I've been doing a version of this talk for most of this year, and that's because the next book that I'm working on is this. So the one that we just finished is about inner source, and we'll talk more about that in a minute. But how many of you have ever read Open Sources, the very first book about open source? Yeah? And then there was an Open Sources 2, which was about the diaspora of the open source idea, and that was published about 10 years ago. So it's been 10 years, it's time for another one. So we're doing Open Sources 3, which is a series of essays, and it's intended to be stories we forgot to write down as we were living through them that inform how we know which choices to make. And when I'm saying we, I mean people who've been working to build this movement for the last, you know, X years, right? There's a whole new wave of people that have come into open source, which is excellent. And certainly their energy and enthusiasm is wonderful to have. But there's lots of stuff they don't know about how to do what we do. And as I'm hearing them talk about it, and I was the chair of the Node Foundation for the first 2 years that we had one, they were there was a lot of, oh my gosh, they're going to make the same mistakes we made over again. You know, those who don't study history are doomed to repeat it. And so then it occurred to me that we hadn't done a very good job of helping them understand. So that's that book. And I went into all of that because if, as you're listening to this, a story comes up for you that helped you understand how to make choices for open source, and you feel like you've nailed it, I'd love your chapter. It'll be an O'Reilly book. So, okay. So this presentation is structured around six things that I think are very important to open source. Some of this material has already been in a keynote, but it's decorated with stories from the real open source trenches. And I try to use different stories every time I do it. So these are new ones. First of all, this is the first thing. Transparency is not negotiable in open source. If it's not transparent, it's not open source, as far as I'm concerned. And how many agree? Yeah? It's basic, right? You'd be surprised how fully you have to express that. If you're, so the first slide was a little girl being a superhero. I would posit that you're all superheroes if you work in open source. By definition, open source people are that. And they are that because they go the step further. They're not just riding the wave of the movement, but they're actually shaping it through their actions. And not allowing non-transparent things to call themselves open source is the first call to action I have for you. So if you're working on a project or you work for a company that is claiming to do open source, but some aspect of it isn't transparent, then you got to call it out. It's your job. And it feels scary the first time, but you know, after that, not so much. The most recent example of this that I can think of is maybe when Apache called out the licensing on React and got Facebook to change it, right? And originally, they weren't going to change it, but then public opinion kind of swayed them in the direction. And that is the main enforcement method that built open source. That requires people to take a risk and call out whatever it is they see, right? All right, so here's an example of a guy who really did that. This is an ex-Apache guy. I mean, he's still an Apache guy to us, but he doesn't work much on Apache projects anymore. The guy in the middle, that's Brian Fitzpatrick, and when he was at Google, working in the open source office, he realized that Google was starting to eat the world's data. I mean, that's the business model, right? It eats the world's data and sells what it learns. He thought it was important that as the first company to found itself on that basis, Google baseline good practices around data hygiene. Like, it's your data, you should be able to get it back. So he started something called the Data Liberation Front inside of Google. And of course, he had a lot of support from his boss and others, but it was still a fairly radical thing for him to do. And he ran around Google cleaning up the whole story of, can I get my data back? And that's why I don't worry so much about Google acquiring things, because so far, at least, every project they've acquired, the first thing they've done is figure this out. How do we make sure people can get their data back? So yay him, right? That was an easy one. I think it was about 3 years of his life. Okay, this is the second tenet of open source. Open source is people. Are there Drupal people in the audience? I know there's at least one. So this is the Drupal community. They do a picture every time they do a conference, and it gets bigger and bigger. The first one, there's, you know, maybe 40 people, right? This is not even a recent one. They get bigger and bigger. So why is that important? Well, at Apache, we say, community over code. At Drupal, they say, come for the code, stay for the community. That idea that we're people working together is really key to successful open source. And, you know, many of us have kind of made enough friends in open source that we take our vacations with open source people, we got married to somebody we met in open source, or we started a business with somebody that we met. It's basic to who we are. And if you're not centric that way, there's a problem. And there's some famous open source projects where the main person isn't good with people. And these days, the new group of people that are coming in to look at open source, they're not willing to let that stand. They want people to be nice to each other. And they're kind of dragging us in the direction, some of us kicking and screaming, to be, you know, generally kind. Are you kind? It's one thing to tell the truth. It's another thing to be kind while you're telling the truth. I think that's a basic tenet of successful open source projects as well. So, and here it is. Those of you who came for the Apache story, I'm going to tell you the creation story of Apache now. How many of you know this story already? Because either you were there or you know. Yeah, there's a little contingent of Apache folks because of the backstage roadshow conference. Okay, so this is the 10th anniversary of Apache. And this is a European conference in Amsterdam, and you'll see that I am sitting apart. That's because I was the, shall we say, moderator of this panel of people who were around at the dawn of Apache. Okay? So you probably all know, everybody in open source seems to know, that Apache started from Rob McCool's code that a bunch of people, initially I think 13 people, noticed that they were each patching this web server code that Rob McCool wrote when he was at Carnegie Mellon. They were picking it up and working on it and patching it, and they started realizing they were all working on it. And a couple of people got involved in really helping them shape that into a movement, right? What most people don't know is the moment of the beginning of the Apache Software Foundation. It was a good 5 years after these people realized that they were all working on the same project and started calling themselves Apache. About 5 years in, they decided to create a foundation, a legal entity that was a nonprofit. But very few people know really why that happened. It happened because as the Apache software server, the web server, got more and more important in the world of the web, and at one point it had, you know, unbelievable market share, something like in the 80s%. It's down a little bit now, but it's still the dominant web server in the world, which is kind of amazing, right? But back in the early days, they all wanted to distinguish themselves. They, the original people that were working hard to make the web server good, they each wanted that to be their calling card for their career, and they each wanted to start a company. And in fact, they all did start companies. And then they started suing each other over intellectual property concerns, right? And so Apache almost didn't happen because it was this tarball of lawsuits. But then, and rather magically, these two guys, especially the one, this one, Brian Ballendorf, but also Roy Fielding, convinced this group, by then of about 22 principal players, that if they grew the pizza bigger, everybody's slice would automatically get bigger. But in order to do that, they would have to start agreeing not to sue each other. And so the founding document that made the Apache Software Foundation was a fax. You guys know about faxes? Anybody here remember faxes? Okay. One of the great things about the early days of faxes was you didn't necessarily have to cut the page at the A4 length or the 11-inch length. You could actually create a long scroll if you just kept adding and told it not to cut. And there's this long, scrolly document with everybody's signature signing off on the legal charter that said, we're going to stop suing each other. We're now a foundation together. So that took some belief and some serious diplomacy on the part of these two guys to get that group of people to realize that there was enough room for everybody to make money in the marketplace if they just worked together instead of stopping the ugliness. And that's partly why the Apache license was the first license that had decent IP protection written into it. So, third thing, companies like strategic advantage. They like to use open source as a strategic advantage thing. like pawns on a chessboard. They want to move people around. They think that we're fungible, but we're not very fungible. Most of us are not, anyway. We like to work on what we like to work on. Programmers are artists, I believe, not so much cogs in a wheel, but companies really like the whole cogs in a wheel thing. And so you have to work hard to counterbalance that. And it's your job, again, as a superhero, to call that out when you see it and to refuse to play if you find yourself in that situation. So here's a guy, also an Apache guy. This is Jason Hunter. Jason is standing between Scott McNeely, who was the CEO of Sun in this picture, and Rob Jingle, who at the time was the CTO. Now, this was during a time, so a little bit of background. I got hired by Sun in 1999 to open source Java. But they didn't actually get around to open sourcing Java until early 2006. So there was a long period of time there where they weren't getting to the thing I was supposed to help them do. And it was clear it needed to happen. They'd made public announcements about it, but there were all these people dragging their knuckles pretty hard, and they didn't want it to happen. But they did want people to believe it was happening. So we recruited Apache as a member of the JCP, a founding member of the JCP, as a shorthand for the open source people like us too. And Tomcat was already happening at Apache. But this guy, Jason, was the Apache VP in charge of talking to Sun about Java. He spent, I don't know, like a year of his life, over a period of years, on the phone with Sun in these long, crazy meetings. There was another guy named Doug Lee, who's an academic, who was the other guy who represented not a big corporation. And the two of them started asking questions of me about the agreements that were being drafted for the Java community process. So I'm reading these documents and telling them what questions I would be asking if I was in the meetings they were in. Because by this time, Sun had decided I wasn't going to those meetings anymore. Because they knew that I was, you know, on the side of the community, and they didn't necessarily want that voice from Sun in those meetings. So I figured, well, then I guess my job is to help the community. So I'm reading these documents and sending them notes. And at one point I said, you know, it would be interesting to ask, could we still do Tomcat under this agreement? Because reading the agreement, it was becoming less and less open source friendly, right? That question, they happened to ask it on a day when only the lawyer from Sun had showed up to the meeting. Everybody else, for some reason, was called in another direction. And it was the perfect question to ask when he had his defenses down. He said, oh God, no, I don't think even Sun could still do Tomcat under this agreement. Sort of proudly said that. And they went back and went, oh, this is not good. And Jason came back to the board and said, by the way, the agreement that they're about to make seriously available to everybody, require everybody to sign, is going to make it impossible to do Tomcat or any open source. So I think we should leave. And the threat of Apache leaving actually got Sun to cave on the idea of this agreement. And they wrote something called the Apache Compromise, which was the agreement that allowed Apache to create compatible versions of reference implementations as long as they passed the TCK. And there was some language in there about the terms under which the TCK, that's the compatibility test kit, would be made available. Okay, this is Java 1. The Apache Compromise happened a week before Java 1, and this is a story about me taking my career in my own hands. So a week before Java 1, the Apache Compromise was written, and the 300 at that time members of Apache were not going to leave the JCP and embarrass Sun during Java 1, right? But I convinced them that Sun that it wasn't a good idea to never say anything about the Apache Compromise at Java 1. Now, I didn't go through the PR people, because they hated the open source practice. They were forever trying to keep us quiet, right? What I did was I went straight to Rob Jingle, and I said, you know, this compromise that you set out, nobody knows about it. It would be great if somebody like Jason could walk on stage at Java 1, and there'd be a photo op of you and him shaking hands, and then the Apache people could quiet down. He said, yeah, that sounds like a good idea. So I brought him to Java 1 at 6 in the morning, like you do before a big keynote, right? Of course, he was out of it. We were walking across Howard Street, and we ran into a woman I knew. Her name was Tracy. She was in charge of brand, and she was on heels, like marketing people sometimes are. we're running across the street, and she says, "What are you doing here?" And so I introduce her to Jason, and I tell her that he's going to have a walk-on between two keynotes, like 2 minutes on stage, just a photo op to say the Apache Compromise is a good thing, yay. She was like, "Huh, what is the Apache Compromise?" Well, it's about the eventual open sourcing of Java. So we go to our separate corners once we get in the big building. Jason and I are standing in front of the stage talking to James Gosling, and because he doesn't have a lot of access to Gosling, he's like this, you know, he's got his headset on. He's nervous because it's going to be 15,000 physical people in the audience, plus however many millions are watching the live stream. He's scared, right? And so Gosling's trying to calm him down. And Jingle's standing there too, and we're trying to make him feel comfortable. Meanwhile, unbeknownst to us, in the green room, Scott McNeely, who has a keynote that day, is not liking his keynote material. And Scott was like this. He's got these 3x5 cards, and he's throwing them around the green room because he hates them. He's like, "This is stupid. I can't say this. I'm the CEO of a very interesting and dynamic company. There has to be more news than this that I can talk about." Right? And everybody in the back is freaking out, right? And so Tracy, between arguments, Tracy goes, "I ran into Danese on the sidewalk. She's got this kid from Apache, and they're going to talk about open source Java." And he says, "I want that kid." So she comes toddling out from the back, and Jason's standing there being nervous, and she comes up to me and she says, "Scott would like Jason in his keynote." It still cracks me up. And he said, "Should we do this?" And I said, "Are you okay?" And he said, "I think so." I said, "Yeah." So he goes to the back. Now, I have just taken my career in my hands because nobody at Sun knows this announcement's going to happen in the keynote. There's no press worked up about it. There's no briefing documents. There's a million analysts in the room, and they're all going to hear that Java's going to be open sourced from the CEO standing on stage shaking Jason's hand. And that's what happened. And at Java One, I was like Isabel. You sit right in the front row, except there are 15,000 chairs, and everybody in the block about this size behind you is a VP from Sun. So he's just said the words, and I can feel the hate. Right? But we survived that. Everybody wanted to talk to me all of a sudden instead of all of the people that they'd set up briefings for. If you go look at the coverage on that day, it's amazing, right? Because it was real news. So anyway, it's possible to survive this kind of chance, but as Duncan Davidson and I used to say to each other, if we get fired for trying to open source Java, is that going to hurt our careers? I don't think so. All right, here's another person who took a huge chance. Does anybody know who this is? No? No Americans? That is Jennifer Palka. She's married to Tim O'Reilly, and she runs something called Code for America. Now, she was working as a conference organizer. That was her job. And she was working a lot with Tim. The conference she was organizing was called Web 2.0, which was a big deal back in the day. But what she wanted to do was fix her country. That's what she actually wanted to do. And hanging around with Tim and going to conferences about hacking government, using open source thought to hack government, really inspired her. And she quit her day job and she started this thing called Code for America. And Tim thought it was such a good idea. He started hanging out with her a lot at Code for America and trying to support her because he wanted to see the country get better through open source means. Well, they're married now, so there was that paid off, right? But also, they've done a lot of good, not just in the US. What they do is they negotiate deals with cities. They start at the city level or the town level. A city needs something, a better way to talk about when the buses are going to arrive is a typical one, or a way to tell people where crime is happening in the city, or there's a number of other ones, where the polling places are, where lots of things like this. And they bid on it along with everybody else in the tender, but they've got the benefit of open source, and so they almost always can win the tender. In fact, her problem now is she's got too much work. And then they send people kind of like in the US we have this thing called the Peace Corps, which I was in, where rich American kids give back. Instead of doing military service, they go somewhere and teach on behalf of America. So this is like that. They go somewhere and code on behalf of America. And Code for America doesn't pay a living wage because they're headquartered in San Francisco. You can't live in San Francisco on what they pay. But people take a year off and do this as a give back. And it started out being kids mostly, I mean like fresh from school, but these days it's professionals who have kind of arrived and would like to do some giving back and have about a year of time and can afford it. So if it's interesting to you, it's a good idea. She's also promulgated this idea all over the world. So there's code for India. There might even be code for Germany, for all I know. It's worth looking at. But this is a story about how just one person's interest can grow if you focus on that, let's make the pie bigger because our slices will be bigger, instead of, I need to own this, right? She's all about getting out of the way of the thing. And if you go look her up online, she's got tons of really good talks that she's given. She's telling the truth these days about Oracle and the way that they license to government and how both lock-in and expensive it is. When Oracle starts saying that open source is dangerous, you know that it's, you know, time to switch hatred from Microsoft to Oracle, right? Like, I would like to take them apart now. All right, another tenet. This is about patronage. At least at this stage, open source partially works on patronage. So when you employ me, you get an automatic belief on the part of the people that pay attention that open source is getting serious for your company. The price of that is not every single thing I work on is going to be your prime directive, because I work for open source. So if the fork in Node needs healing, I'm going to try to dive into that problem if I think I'm well positioned to take it on. If, I worked for OSI for 10 years and read everybody's license, not just my employer's license. Patronage is a really big part of how open source works, at least today. Now, here's a guy. This is Dr. Peter Korn. He was a prominent accessibility theorist at Berkeley who got a job at Sun about the time that GNOME, G-N-O-M-E, some people call it different things in different countries, being formed. All of the major Unix vendors were supporting GNOME because they needed a new interface, because the Mac was eating their lunch, basically. The Mac and Windows was making Unix less and less appealing to people. And so GNOME and Sun's involvement in it was about creating a new interface for Unix, as was IBM's and HP's, and there were a lot of other big companies feeding into that, right? So he put the world's best accessibility into GNOME at the time. It was better than what Apple was selling. And it was, world-class accessibility tools in a free product, which was so counterintuitive to so many people. I had a number of conversations inside of Sun about giving up the IPR to this, intellectual property rights, by making it open source. There was a lot of concern that they were giving up a competitive advantage, because this was the early days of Sun understanding open source. And my basic pitch was, if more people in the world can use technology, that's more potential customers for you. I think you need to water this garden. We were able to persuade them. But this is the kind of thing that's hard to persuade companies that are focused on optimizing for profit, like Oracle. All right. Another one, money changes everything, universally. You want to understand a system, look at where the money goes. And that's true in open source as well. So we have some situations right now. There are some very well-meaning people who have been growing a deep pocket of money, and they think they're doing it for the right reasons, but I have concerns. And the reason I have concerns is because I've been involved with Apache for a really long time now. Apache runs as economically as it possibly can. For a long time, it ran on less than $500,000 a year. Largest open source repository, a single project repository in the world, less than $500,000 a year. That was by design. And that design allowed Apache to weather some really hard times over the years. Now, this is Michael Rogers. Michael is really the guy who healed the Node fork. I got to work on it, but Michael's really the guy that did most of the heavy lifting. He was in the community already. He was well positioned to persuade the people that forked Node that it would be better if Node remerged. Now, my job in that project was to convince the copyright holder, which was Joyent, that it was time to give the IP up to a foundation. And it turns out the Linux Foundation was the only place where the IP holder felt comfortable. And Jim Zemlin has done a very good job of learning how to talk to people who are open source newbies at the corporate level. They don't want to get it wrong. They don't want to waste an arrow, as it were. They don't want to, they know that they don't know what they're doing. And he's good at persuading them that he's going to help them along the way, and he kind of understands them. Unfortunately, most Linux, not all, but most Linux Foundation projects are set up as pay-to-play projects. That means that you buy, thank you, you buy a seat at the table. And by buying that seat, you are saying that you're going to be on the board. You have a vote on the board. It's possible to buy a vote, is what I'm telling you. Unfortunately, for somebody like me, I was the chair for 2 years, and then my company, PayPal, decided that that was enough paying, and they weren't going to pay anymore, and that meant I couldn't serve on the board, which is a pretty big problem if you've been, you know, sort of forming the project as you go along. So I have a fundamental problem with pay-to-play, which is I think that any open source project should allow, through sweat equity, the ability to serve in any capacity that you want to on the project. And if you can't do that, then I think it's not open source. So I'm not saying that the Linux Foundation is bad or wrong. I think that Jim is trying very hard to do a good thing. He wants to prove you can pay a living wage in open source. That's why he set it up the way that he does and why he earns so much for his projects. But I'm not positive that it's the right way to go. And I think if there's a downturn, we're going to see some pain among Linux Foundation nonprofits, and we're going to have to help some of them to continue to survive. So Michael was a real hero because he risked personal reputation to get that merge to happen of the node code. All right, and then the last one is you've got to focus on the tech. As interesting as it is to focus on social justice or any number of other issues that you can work on within an open source community, the tech has to come first because that's why we're there. If we start turning out substandard tech, nobody's going to care about the rest of what we do. And one of my problems with the current inclusion efforts that want to do a revolutionary change is that they tend to want to throw the tech under the bus in the name of the social justice movement that's being pushed. And I think that's a wrong step. So you guys know these guys? This is recent news. Does everybody know who these guys are? So that one founded GitHub. That one is the current CEO of Microsoft, and that one is going to run GitHub if that merge is allowed to happen. Now, that's Nat Friedman, and he is a hero. He has worked on two projects that are really, really well-conceived, interesting projects, Xamarin and Zimian. They like these X names a lot. I don't know why. He's best friends with Miguel de Icaza, who wrote the first open source implementation of .NET, which was called Mono, or C Sharp, which was called Mono. And we thought that Miguel was going to get, you know, like thrown in jail for a long time. He managed to surf the politics of that for a long time and eventually get it right. He fell in love with the elegance of the design of the whole .NET system and decided to port it to open source. He was given a very narrow amount that he was allowed to port, and he went a lot further than he was supposed to, banking on the fact that Microsoft wouldn't take action against him because it would be such bad PR for them to do it. And he was really brave because it was at a time when Ballmer was still in power and they did do that kind of thing all the time, right? But Nat is interesting to me, and the reason that I'm not worried about that merger, even though everybody's hosting on GitHub, is because I know Nat. Nat has done a very good job over the years of walking the line between the corporate desire to get things done a certain way and the actual open source ethic, which he totally understands. So I'm feeling pretty good about the way that GitHub will go going forward. I mean, if it doesn't work out, we'll all just migrate to GitLab. But I'm not in a hurry to do it right now because I believe that Nat is probably going to do the right thing. And also, because I've been working on InnerSource all this time, I need tools in projects like GitHub that make InnerSource easier to do. And this is more likely to make that happen. And I am no lover of the way Microsoft has worked. You guys will know that that's the case. Okay, here's another person who's a hero in this vector. This is Adafruit Lemur. I don't know if you guys have ever run across this lady, but there's lots of YouTube video of her. She's Israeli. She runs a physical Internet of Things lab. She kicks ass. She's so undeniably excellent, even though she's a girl and has pink hair. And to me, she's a hero of example, there's a lot of talking about how, you know, marginalized people should work in open source, but she actually pulls it off every day, and she's you know, badass. She doesn't spend a lot of time gnashing her teeth about it either. She just buckles in and works. Now, Apache recently had a conversation at my instigation about the use of the term meritocracy, which we started using 25 years ago to describe the way that you gradually gain reputation through your direct actions. We've been talking about what else to call it, because that word has been discredited by the inclusion community because they feel that it's too high a bar for marginalized people to be expected to show up in an alpha geek way in order to gain reputation. We've been talking lately about finding another word. The word duocracy was very interesting in the discussions that I saw. The idea is, you know, what have you done for us lately? You are what you show up to do. Even that idea is problematic for some people in the inclusion community, and I think we're going to see a gradual sifting in this next 5 years of that situation, where we get to a place that everybody understands that open source is about rolling up your sleeves and working in the capacity that you can. I would like to see us gain more kindness for people that aren't, you know, super alpha geeks. But I do think at the end of the day, we have to focus on technology and get stuff done. So people that can do that are heroes of mine. All right, so now you guys are all superheroes too. And hopefully this conversation has brought up for you the thought, oh my gosh, I've seen some stuff that's concerning to me. I guess it is on me. I've been waiting for somebody else to call it out, but maybe it's my job to call it out. Now, I'm not advocating, you know, Trump-style 3 a.m. angry tweeting, okay? I don't think that's even all that useful, but I am advocating being the change you want to see and standing that ground. That's our job as open source people, and the history supports it right down to the ground. We can't give up on that now. It's very easy for companies to slide back in the old direction, and we do not want to see that happen. Trust me, if you worked in tech in those days, you would know how much better this is and why we don't want to go back. All right, so this is the logo for InnerSource. If any of you have an interest in InnerSource, which is using open source methods inside your company, I'm very happy to talk to you about that after. I'll be around both days. We have a book coming out at OSCON that's about that. And the idea here is we have to start training more open source developers. They're not getting it in school. They're not getting it at work. If we can convince companies that this is a better way to make software, and we know that it is because it works for us, then if we can convince them that it's going to solve problems they have, bottlenecks they've created in their engineering culture, then we get a whole nother crop of engineers that know how to collaborate in this way and could become future open source collaborators. I think it's 80 or 90% of the engineers in the world have still never gotten to work this way in their career, and we have to change that. I think InnerSource is the way we do that. All right, so that's what I have to say, and I think I am really close to time. But I am willing to take a question or two if you guys can formulate them quickly, because I don't want to push people over the edge. I said a lot of controversial things. Come on, somebody's not happy. Going once. God, I must be losing my grip if nobody wants to strangle me now. Come on, I didn't hurt any of the Apache feelings. Not one. No. All right. Oh, there's one.
There's only one disagreement I have to make, and that is actually the be kind to each other. I think Linux is proof of that actually is not required for open source software to work.
Ah, but they had to hire or recruit Greg Crowe-Hartman to counterbalance Linus's gruffness, right? So yes, you're right, it can be worked around. And I'm certainly not a fan. There are inclusionists who believe that Linus should be run out of his own project as an example and to teach people to be nicer. NPM is run that way. If they meet people who hurt people's feelings, they exclude them because they're exclusionists. I think we can't afford to exclude. Just because we won doesn't mean that we can afford to push away, you know, excellent technologists. And I believe that Linus's project would not work as well without him there. But notice that they had to recruit somebody to make him less abrasive because they couldn't get where they needed to go. That should tell you that, you know, kindness is actually, even in Linux, a major thing. So, yeah.
Hi.
Hi.
Just wondering how you mentioned 5 years from now. Just wondering how you pictured the landscape there. I mean, yeah, can you speak to that at all?
Sure. Thanks. Well, so you know, containerization and cloud native computing creates yet another opportunity for companies to find loopholes. And I think we have to, that's why I'm trying to create an army of people who go, oh, hell no. Because I think it would be very easy for this whole thing to slide backwards along with all the other weird xenophobia that we're seeing in the world. I think we have an opportunity as a community to defy that behavior. But it's going to require that we do things like speak up about net neutrality so we don't lose our common ground, right? US is doing stupid things to net neutrality right now. And if you have a vote in the US, go online now, look up net neutrality, figure out who you're supposed to yell at, and do it, because now is the time for that. We have proven time and again that our voice, our collective voice, can keep things open and keep things real, but we have to show up. So I think if we don't, we're going to lose a substantial portion of the forward progress that we've made, and that's my concern. Does that help? Great.
Okay, you talked about the acquisition of GitHub by Microsoft.
Yeah.
Do you think that Microsoft will change the way open source is done so that it's, for example, more compatible to traditional businesses like an automotive company? Or will Microsoft be the example for all other big companies to learn to adapt to the open source way?
Well, I think we want that second option to be true, right? They're still a leopard. They still want to eat you, but now they want to eat you with a smile. They're not, right? And so again, it's up to us to say, if they start being shenanigans that don't feel right, we need to say that. By the way, this isn't open source, Microsoft. You're screwing up, we're all going to go to GitLab. The right to fork is a huge thing. But everybody has to agree to do that. It's too early to do it now. I do think that has a chance to make them an example. And I think they want to modernize in that way. They want to prove. I mean, most people will tell you that Apple can't do open source, but they did WebKit. And while it wasn't a perfect open source project, it was better than we thought we would get from them. Right? And it may be that GitHub is going to end up feeling that way, but it's up to us to continually remind them. And in a way that they can hear it, that they've gone too far, right? So.
And that's another question. What do you think about the trend of the cloud companies like Alibaba or Amazon, also sponsored from Hissy, are using and also contributing, but not in the same effort as they use it? Do you have the fear that there will be a cloud curtain, like Iron Curtain here in Berlin?
Cloud native computing could cause a problem. Alibaba is the way it is, and Chinese companies don't understand open source yet. They're trying to understand it, but they don't get it. Huawei is the other big Chinese company that's been trying to figure it out. They've interviewed every male open source advocate that is looking for work that I know, and nobody's said yes yet because they're really honest. When you come in to meet with them, I understand. They haven't talked to me about it, but they say things like, we need to understand how to get around open source. And any good advocate will say, not with me, you're not doing that, right? So they're trying to understand it. They're putting resources sort of selectively in places where they want it to go. Alibaba's not really playing at all in open source yet. And once again, we have an opportunity to make sure that the right players win, to reward people who are showing up and, you know, entice people who aren't. The best example of this I can think of, how many of you know about the statistical language R? Do you guys know about R? Okay, so R is an open source language. The reason that you know about it is because every university that teaches statistics uses it. Even though SAS, which is the company in South Carolina that produces S, the original language that Bell Labs wrote for statistics, they have a completely closed, hermetically sealed, and by the way, not publicly traded company. And they own statistics until R got good enough to supplant them. These days, there are companies that don't even go to SAS. They're picking R because you can get everything you need to get done, and you can see what's happening, and the models are transparent, it's set up to be extensible, and everybody learns it in school. Some really big companies are using it much more effectively than S, And SaaS isn't changing because the guy who runs it is going to die before things change. But it will fall over as a company. It's been slowly strangled because there's R, right? That will happen. That commoditization will happen everywhere. But we have to support it. We have to show up. If we don't show up, believe me, this will go backwards. Believe me, it will. Because it's much easier to make money the old-fashioned way, by obscuring things and putting out shite products and then waiting until the capitalization has fully vested before you fix things. That's how it used to be. Also, people coming in and raiding each other, right? There are some really big companies that are teetering on the edge of evil. They could go either way. Some of them are big cloud companies that aren't showing up properly yet, but they could. They're making noise about it. I'd love to see that change. Right? So again, we're the policemen. Every time we look externally for an answer, we're cheapening the movement. It's up to us. And we have to help this new wave understand that as well. So hopefully you guys got that. If you want to hear any other stories or you have a story you want to share, I'll be around until the end of the conference. And thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much, Danese.